Now it's time for the announcements.
Good morning.
Good evening.
Good to be with you this evening. Not playing hooky tonight. I just wanted to hear Pastor Chapman preach, and so he's going to preach for me this evening. I remember hearing this story about this guy that kept standing up in the service and saying, "Use me, Lord, use me." And he just kept doing that week after week, and finally the pastor said to him as he was leaving the service one morning, he said, "You know, you keep praying, you just keep calling out to the Lord, saying, 'Use me, Lord, use me.'" And there's a table downstairs that's needing some paint put on it there. And I thought maybe you'd like to let the Lord use you to do that. And so he did. He painted the table. But then he came in the next Sunday and he stood up and said, "Use me, Lord, use me." But he said, "But use me in an advisory capacity." So tonight, I'm going to be used in an advisory capacity. Somebody else is going to preach. Let's ask the Lord to bless us. Father in heaven, I pray that you would bless the service tonight, that we would accomplish everything that you want us to accomplish, nothing more, nothing less, Father. And I pray, Lord, that we would please you with what we do. Pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I just want to tell you this morning, I surprised a pastor with an honorary doctorate And that was a true blessing. This is a pastor that's had 30 years worth of real productive ministry. He's been a real good friend to our Bible college, and he's been a great support to us. And I snuck in 5 minutes late into the back so he wouldn't know I was there. His wife helped me to arrange all this, and when I come up front and called him up, he just had this shocked look on his face, and he never got rid of the shocked look the whole time I was with him. He was really blessed by it. It was really a blessing to be able to do that. So that's where I was this morning, and Randy, come up and lead us in some singing. You want this? You want this?
I don't know. I Pastor. No wonder his son gave up on him about 30 years ago. His father gave up on him about 30 years ago. Uh-huh. Well, he was hoping for 20 years out of you. Well, we're glad that you're here this morning. Let's do make some announcements. We do have a watch of the sunrise service here, and then there will be, as far as I understand, it will be a breakfast here served that morning after service. So I don't know. I do not know what will be served, but it will be served. If it's just biscuits and gravy, it would make me happy. That's
Randy, Melissa asked me to ask anybody that if they wanted to bring something for the breakfast. I have a list that she gave me, knowing what the breakfast is going to be.
Okay.
So if you wanted to bring something Wednesday night or whatever, I've got the list for you to choose from.
Okay. So there you go. Asked Gene, and we'll find out what you have for that Sunday morning. Also, on April the 2nd, we will be having communion service. So keep that in mind for some of the upcoming service coming our way. Then the alabaster, today is the last day for alabaster, right, Barb? Today is the last day that we can get. I mean, we can give money later, but this is the last officially, unofficially day. And then also we need to have the faith promise coming by May the 1st. Those that you know how much you promised. So try to get that in. Mark it as faith promise so it will go directly to that one department. So it would be counted and credited. And so somehow, I don't know, maybe we can turn that into from red to green. Maybe, I don't know how you do that, but get paint, or I don't know, but keep that in mind, it's up and coming. As we enter into the Easter time, draw our attention to the very knowing of the Lord and Master. And I was asked to have a song this evening, and I believe it's an old one, an old good one. All because of God's amazing grace. 354, 354 in the hymn book, or Mike will probably have it on the wall. Sing out. Amazing grace, oh how sweet the hymn that saved a poor sinner. My place and God's amazing grace. Through disappointment and anger too, through labors and sorrows we've gone, but God's grace hath guided, saved way through, and it will surely lead us home. And it's all because of God's amazing grace, because on Calvary's mountain He took my place. And someday, some glorious morning, I shall see Him face to face, all because of God's amazing grace. Then with a realm God through will praise thy Redeemer and King. His mercy sended a tongue through countless ages, this song we'll sing. It was all because of God's amazing grace, because on Calvary's mountain He took my place. And someday, some glorious morning, I shall see Him face to face, all because of God's amazing grace. I want you so glad, nothing that we have done, nothing of anything, but because of God's amazing grace that we have. And also, Brother Bob Niley will be having that sunrise service, so I wanted to bring out, I said sunrise, but he will be also speaking that morning too. I think it's maybe because our pastor can't get up that time in the morning. You know, he needs that beauty rest. Someone have a song you want to sing?
You can use those since it's
not. You think? Okay. Jean wasn't for sure about it because of her arthritis and her fingers of singing some of these songs. And one of them, I think, 696 is the one. We don't sing it enough. It's kind of hard to sing, but I love the song. No, it's 358, ladies. 358. I'm sorry. I think because of His amazing grace, He's so precious to us, and we don't sing that enough. That's one of my favorites of the hymn book. Whenever you get ready, ladies, go ahead. 358. But He is so precious to us, and the meaning of the words of that song. Go ahead, whenever you're ready. Just cut me off. Precious is Jesus, my Savior, my King. His praise all the day long with rapture I sing. To Him in my weakness, for strength I can cling. For He is so precious to me. To me, 'tis heaven below, my Redeemer to know, for He is so precious to me. He stood at my heart's door in sunshine and rain, and patiently waited an interest to gain. What shame that so long He entreated in vain, for He salvation to me. Cloud in the heavens, a shadow to kiss. His smile is upon me, the valley is past. For he is so precious to me. To you this evening in our lives that we do within the saving grace of Him. Let's try one more. 696. 696. Tell it to Jesus. If you're a heavy hearted lady, tell it to Jesus. Love to tell the story, I mean. I'm sorry, ladies. I love to tell of unseen things above, of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story.
To tell
that story through. So glad to tell the old, old story. You want to come up?
I didn't really want to come up here. I just wanted to get him out of the pulpit. All right. We want to go to the Lord in prayer. And I wonder if you have requests that you'd like to share that we could pray for. Yes. Whereabouts was it? Where was it? Oh, yeah.
We sent down in the new marijuana dispensary.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, I don't know where that is. I'll ask Randy later. He'll know. Oh, okay. Oh, it looks bad then. Yeah. That sounds really bad. Okay. I'll imagine so.
Yeah.
Well, I know nobody wants to do that, but they do it pretty well, you know. Okay. My former district superintendent with the Wesleyan Church, his wife also had esophageal cancer, and she's been in treatment for that for several months now, and it was a very large mass at the near the bottom of the esophagus, and she was having trouble eating. She was real skinny anyway, so. I wish you would pray for her and her husband. It's hard for the whole family as they deal with it. It's Greg Reynolds, and Becky is his wife's name. Who else? Yeah. Okay. 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 Let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Father, we are again thankful that we have the privilege of coming to you in prayer. Lord, we thank you that you delight in the prayer of the upright. Father, we pray for each of these needs that were mentioned, Lord. We know that you're able to do whatever you want to, Father. You're able to surprise us with your goodness, Lord. I pray, Father, that you would do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. Each of these things, Father. Lord, I pray for each one who's sick and those that are looking after them, Lord, that you'd help them. Father, for those that have started coming here recently, we pray, Lord, that you would encourage them, bless them. You got a special? Oh, okay. Well, I think it looks on her face, she sprung it on her. Oh, okay. When they finish, Cecil, will you come on up? And when you finish preaching, just close the service out, okay?
Okay, Mike. We're going to do a song tonight. We want you as a congregation to join in with us. It's one of these songs that we are not familiar with. Riley has worked with us and talked with us and dealt with us and wanted to do some of these things. And I never want to discourage anybody that was willing to do things for the cause of God and doing the things that he would have us to do. It's supposed to be up on the Okay. This I believe. Try to help us sing. I don't know. Let's go. Thank you.
Friday was St. Patrick's Day. And as I was reading my daily devotional on Friday, it came up and it was talking about St. Patrick. And long ago, St. Patrick was a missionary. But let's go back. Let's look at St. Patrick's Day. We know what it is in a secular world today. You know, you have to wear green, and if you don't wear green, you know, you get pinched. You know, we see that today. That's the secular part of it. But people forgot about what St. Patrick did or who St. Patrick actually was. So St. Patrick lived in the AD 400s, and he was a young 13-year-old who was kidnapped by some raiders and taken to Ireland, where he was enslaved for 6 years. 6 whole years he was a slave. And when he was freed and he was an adult at that time, he became a great missionary. And that's where I'm going to stop for a few minutes. And if you have your Bibles, and if you'll turn to Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. And we all know this scripture. And if you're able to stand with me, please stand for the reading of God's word. Matthew 28, verse 19 says, "Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit." And Pastor Bob, I'd ask him to have our prayer.
Our precious loving Father, we thank you for the service and the wonderful songs that we sung and through the special. And we pray for a special anointing upon Master Cecil right now. We pray the anointing would be upon him. You would give him, Heavenly Father, the words of wisdom and the knowledge. And Father, let him share with us that opens our hearts and minds to the truth. Lord, do some radical surgery in our hearts and lives. Help us to realize that, dear Father, that we need to learn more of you and grow into the word. And Father, so now bless your service and all that's said and done. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. I will not be standing here long because I am one who I cannot stand still. So I'm just going to let you know I'll be down, around, and everywhere. But let's talk about St. Patrick. He died in 486 A.D. He was 78 years old. And when he died on March 17th, which they called it St. Patrick's Day. And back then, what St. Patrick's Day was a day that they celebrated because all that he did as a missionary, as a disciple of God. And this was one of his favorite verses that he used because he went all over Ireland, spreading the good news of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He went everywhere. He didn't care where it was. There was no place that St. Patrick was not going to go. And as I was thinking about this, and I was studying about this, and as I was reading this week, and thinking about go and make disciples of all nations.
Amen.
He went all over the country of Ireland and spread the good news. So then he built and founded churches throughout Ireland that spread the good news also. And what's ironic is they had parades and everything in his honor because of what he did after he died. But the secular world turned it into something else. They turned it into a secular holiday that we celebrate. And they make all these things out of green. We don't need to do that. St. Patrick, if we want to look at this verse and we want to look at what it means to make disciples, let's look at St. Patrick, somebody that was enslaved for 6 years, from 13 years old till he was 19 years old, he was an adult. Can you imagine being enslaved as a child for 6 years? And when you're released from slavery, what you want to do is you want to go out and you want to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. You don't want to hold back. And he went all over the world, all over the country, spreading the good news. He was a true disciple of Jesus Christ. He represents what it means to be Christ-like. Amen. He is that example that we see in Matthew 28, verse 19. He went around and spread the good news. Now let's relate that to you and I today. First of all, let's look at two examples of true disciples in the Bible. One that I want to bring up is John the Baptist. John the Baptist was a true disciple because he wanted to spread the word of God. He wanted people to repent and come to know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Amen. And another disciple that probably a lot of people don't look at sometimes as a disciple is Mary. Mary was a true witness to the power of God because she patiently waited the birth of Jesus Christ and the beginning of the kingdom on earth. Can you imagine two better disciples that are examples for us? Coming right out of the Bible. Two great examples of disciples. But what does this say for you and I today? It is telling us that we are to go and make disciples of all nations. And when it says all nations, it doesn't mean that you and I need to get on a plane and go to Africa. It means church. We can do it right here in our community, our surrounding area around the church. It does not matter where it is. It says all nations. But when he says all nations, it can be anywhere that we are as Christians. That's where we need to be spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. We cannot just sit in the pews on Sunday mornings, Sunday nights, and Wednesday nights and call ourselves disciples. If we want to be true disciples, when we walk out that door, we need to be spreading this good news.
Amen.
That Jesus Christ lives.
Amen.
He's alive and well today.
Amen.
In 2023.
Amen.
We don't have to go very far to spread this good news. And there's nothing wrong with going to other countries and spreading the good news. That's what he wants us to do. But if we want to make a difference in our churches locally, and if we want to see our churches grow locally, we have to spread the news around and about us. We cannot just say, I'm going to church on Sunday morning, and when I go out that door, I'm done for the week. I've done my church. That's not what it's about. The Bible doesn't tell us that we're supposed to just sit and listen to what the pastors and the lay people speak about. We have to do what the Bible says. And I like what Pastor, I was thinking about this afternoon, and Pastor Bob today talked about commitment. He talked about commitment. And how many of us are committed to making disciples today? There are so many people out there that think that I'm going to allow Brady to be the one to do the discipling. I'm just going to support him and let him do it. That's not how it works. That's not how it works, church. It's all of our responsibilities.
When we look at this verse, it doesn't say the pastors or the lay person. It says all are to make disciples. All are to make disciples. And if you ask somebody, you know, if you ask, what is a true disciple? A true disciple is when you are Christ-like. It's when you're Christ-like. And when you talk about a true disciple, that's one whose actions speak louder than his words. Because I want to tell you, church, when we leave those doors on Sunday morning, Sunday night, people are looking at us. They know we go to church, and they understand, and they see us in church all the time. And then when they come home, when they see us come home, and we do the worldly things, they're going to be like, why do I need to be a disciple? Why do I need to go to church? Why do I need to go to church?
I like what Pastor Bobby alluded to this. And if you go to Matthew chapter 22, verses 37 through 39, and it talks about, and this is something that St. Patrick, one of the things that he did and he spoke about was he loved God with all his heart, mind, strength, and soul. He was a true lover of Jesus Christ. And if you are a true disciple of Christ and you want to make a difference in this world and you want to spread the good news, it tells us in the first second, it's like the first. We are to love our neighbors as ourselves. And if we are to love our neighbors as ourselves and we want to make them disciples, how are we doing that if we're not spreading the good news? If we love ourselves enough to be in church on Sundays and Wednesdays and worshiping with our brothers and sisters in Christ, shouldn't we want that for everyone we come in contact with? Anyone in this world who is a sinner, who is lost and dying and going to hell, we want to show them the way to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And how do we do that? We love them. We love on them. We show them what it is to be loved.
Amen.
There are so many people out there that are not loved or appreciated. They just are not loved and appreciated. And they get excited when we as Christians give them the time that they want. They need that. There are so many of them that are lost and they don't know where to turn to. So what do? They turn to the secular worldly ways. They find their happiness, what they think is happy, in a bottle or drugs or sex. They look at all these worldly things and think this is going to take care of what, excuse me, they think this is going to take care of what they need. But I'm here to tell you, there's only one thing that can take care of what we need, and that's the love of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And the love that He gave us was when He died on that cross and saved each and every one of us from our sins. He gave us the choice, the free will to choose Him. I choose Him today and forevermore. I want to live my life as the disciple that Jesus Christ wants me to do. I want to continue to spread the good news wherever I go, whoever I come in contact with. And I can promise you this, you're going to get told that I don't want to hear that. And I've been told that over and over again. But you know what? I can be stubborn. And I'm going to continue to witness to those people that have said that to me. I may hear it 100 times, but you know what? I'm not going to give up on them because Jesus Christ doesn't give up on us. He walks side by side with us daily. He takes care of you and He takes care of I. And if He's willing to go the distance for us, shouldn't we be willing to go the distance for others? I spoke on Wednesday night at Bible study about selfless service to others. And I used the chapter in John chapter 13 about the foot washing when Jesus became a slave to His disciples. He became a slave to His disciples. He washed their feet knowing that they were going to betray Him. But you know what? It doesn't matter what people say or what people do. We're expected to spread the good news always and forever.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. One of my favorite sayings, I love, God is going to be here forever and forever and forevermore. There's nothing that we can do to change that. But so many people, when we are trying to be the disciple that Christ wants us to be, and we're trying to make disciples, there's so much going on in this world today that tries to pull us over to the right side. They want us to think, the secular world wants us to think everything is okay and everything is right.
Yes, sir.
And let me tell you why. There's going to be a day and a time when Jesus Christ comes back. There's going to be a lot of people going, man, I wish I listened to Pastor Brady that day. I wish I listened to what Adam had to say. I wish I listened to what Brother Keenan had to say. They're going to regret that they didn't listen.
Yeah.
They're going to regret that they didn't listen because I'm going to tell you, whether people want to know it or not, there is a hell and they will tune. But one of my favorite songs that I love is, I got the joy, joy, joy down in my heart. I've got the joy, joy, joy down in my heart. Isn't it awesome when you have that joy and peace and calmness right here?
Amen.
Because you got Jesus Christ in your heart. I cannot wait to get up on mornings and read my Bible. And I'm so excited when I go to places where I don't know people. Because you know what? I get excited because I get to share the good news with them. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Melissa tells me all the time, you can walk into a room with 100 people and not know anybody. And by the time you come out, you probably know everybody in that room. Because you like to talk and you like to say whatever it is comes to mind. My most exciting thing is, man, I get excited when I can share with the Lord. It just makes me happy. I want to shout across the room. I want to jump up and down for joy. I tell you, I get excited when I think about sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. And especially when I get to talk to people that don't know Him. And they're telling me, I'm going through this, this, and this. It's awesome when we can share things that we went through and things that has happened to us and give them examples of what's going on in our life. Because then they look at you and say, well, how in the world can you be happy if all that happened in your life all these years? Because I have Jesus Christ in my life.
Amen.
He's the reason I'm happy.
Amen.
I don't need a fancy car or a great big house. I'm always telling people, I'd be satisfied when I go to heaven with a cabin in the corner of Glory Land. I don't care about the gold streets of gold. All I care about is I'm going to be with my Lord and Savior forever, for eternity. That's what's important to me. And I get so excited to share the good news of Jesus. I just want to, I can run from the back and front of this sanctuary because I get so excited, There's times I'll be the first to admit it that I've been clear in the back preaching because I get excited. I just can't stand still. And I know I'm probably ADD or ADHD, whatever all those activities or whatever they are. And I don't care. I do it for the Lord. It's not for any other reason. I love my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I love to share that good news. And the good news is, April 9th, we're going to be able to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He may have died a painful death, and they may have scorched Him and whipped Him and all the skin off of His back. They hung Him on that cross. But I'm here to tell you, church, He is alive and well.
Amen.
All we have to do is look. It's what's going on. Now let me tell you what. If you walked out of this service this morning and you weren't filled with the Spirit, you're not committed to what Pastor Bob said. Because let me tell you what, it was a Spirit-filled service this morning. It was awesome to hear Pastor Bob speak. And I have to follow that. But what I love about, we've been coming to this church for a few months. I don't even know how long now. But the fellowship and the friendship. And when we first walked through those doors and how we were made to feel welcome, and I sat down and had probably an hour-long conversation with Pastor Brady the first time we were here. And just the love that you feel. He's a great pastor. And let me tell you what, if you're thinking about joining the church or becoming a Christian, you can talk to him.
Amen.
Somebody mentioned that this morning there's like five or six pastors at this church. I have never been in a church that hasn't had that many pastors. But it's awesome. And we love, Melissa needed not be here tonight. She had to work and she was going to do everything she could to get off. But I said, honey, your job, sometimes our jobs tell us we have to work and you do what you have to do. She's my support. She's my right-hand person. If I have questions, if I need something, she's right there. She supports, she helps. I know I've got Pastor Brady to go to. I've got Pastor Keenan. I've got Pastor Bob. I can talk to anybody. And I love this church. And I love the Spirit.
And I know that we're going to, over the next several months, the way things are going, we're going to see great things.
Amen.
We're going to see great things happen in this church. But it starts right here. It starts right here. And I'm going to use what, take part of Pastor Bob's message from this morning. We need to be committed.
Amen.
We need to be committed to chapter 28, verse 19. We need to go out and make disciples. Wherever He calls us to go, we need to make disciples.
Amen.
That's what He told us. He didn't say, you know, go to church on Sunday and find a pew. You find your favorite pew and have a seat. You know, sometimes, you know, I'm quiet when I'm at church, and sometimes I'm not. You know, God didn't help, and He didn't make all of us the same. Aren't we thankful that He didn't make us all the same? But everybody's different. And some people worship God and they're quiet. Some people are loud. Some people are in between. It doesn't matter. He loves us all. He knows what's in our heart. He knows exactly what's in our heart. And He knows if you're sincere or not. And it came up in Randy's Sunday school lesson this morning. And it goes back to trust. Do we trust Jesus Christ enough to go out and make disciples? Do we trust what that tells us to do?
Yeah.
Amen. We need to trust.
Yes.
There's no greater book in this world than this right here.
Amen.
This right here, the inspired Word of God. And I even think it's on the front of the bulletin from this morning. 2 Timothy, and what, I can't remember the verse all of a sudden, but it talks about, it's the inspired Word of God. This, if we can't trust this, what can we trust? What can we trust? You know, one of the things that I get asked a lot, especially at school, I get asked, well, what do you think about some of these laws of the land that do not quite go with the Bible? I said, well, you know what? They're wrong.
Right.
The Bible is right.
Yeah.
And they're wrong.
Yeah.
You know, I don't have, just because it tells me that I'm supposed to do something that goes completely against what the Bible tells me, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to go against the Bible, because that's the way that's what Jesus wants from me. If I'm going to be the Christ-like disciple, I'm going to make disciples for Him, I have to follow the Bible. I have to follow the Bible. And somebody will, and I've had this one ask me before. So you think that it says to love your neighbors as yourself? Yes, I love everybody the same. Well, what if they're doing this, or what if they're doing that? He didn't tell me I had to love what they were doing.
Right.
He said I had to love that person.
Amen. Amen.
Okay? So if I'm going to be the Christ-like disciple, I'm going to make disciples, what do I need to do in that situation? I need to teach that person what the Bible says about that being wrong if it's against the Bible. So no, I don't have to like their actions, but I have to love them as a person. God made everyone. He made everyone, and everyone has the same choice that we had, to accept Jesus Christ or to deny Jesus Christ. So, yes, I love everyone the same, but I'm not going to love something that's completely against the Bible. But I'm going to show them what the Bible says about it if it's wrong. That's what we're expected to do. That's part of being the Christ-like disciple and making disciples. We can do it. All we have to do is work as a team. And there is no I in team.
Right.
We are a team for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We all work for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We're all here to proclaim the good news. Some of us are called as pastors. Some are called as teachers. Everyone has a special
awesome, you know, about, and that's what I see in this church. There's so much talent in this church. There's so many people that can do so many things. But my challenge, as we get ready to close, my challenge is this week for each, and that is, I'm included in this, and I'm on spring break, so I get a lot of time to spread the good news this week. But my challenge to each of you is, if there is somebody that you know that needs to hear the good news, that you need to share the good news, give them a call. Go visit them. Whatever it is. You know, don't put it off. Because what we don't need to put it off. Because if we put it off and Christ comes tomorrow, what happens to that person that we had lost an opportunity to witness to? We've lost a person for Christ that we could have witnessed to. So as this week starts, think of one person, two people, a family, whoever it might be, that needs to hear the good news.
Amen. Amen.
There's someone that might need to hear the good news. Yeah. Or it may just be somebody that, you know, isn't Christian, but has not been going to church for whatever reason. You know, give them a call. Ask them, you know, they need to talk. There's all kinds of things that we can do to be Christ-like.
Zero.
All kinds of things that we can do. But my challenge is, let's spread the good news. Let's go out and make disciples of all nations.
Amen.
You know, and like I said, all nations means we're our community around us, wherever we are. That's where it starts. We're all not called to go, you know, on a plane and go across the seas. You know, that's what I said. Everybody has their calling. You know, some people will feel more comfortable. And if you want to do it this week and you feel that you can't do it by yourself, I'm going to put Pastor Brady on the spot and say you might give him a call. But if he's not busy, he can give me a call. If I'm, you know, with any of the pastors would be more than willing to go with you just to share the good news with our neighbors. I remember the good old days when I was growing up, when I'd go with my mom and dad, and he'd go, you know, he'd be going around to knocking on the door. Hey, do you go to church anywhere? And they say, no. Well, I'd like to invite you to my church. We meet on Sunday mornings at 9 o'clock or Sunday, whatever the times are, Sunday night. You know, if you don't have a ride, I can remember my parents always, oh, we'll come and pick you up and take you. You don't see that today.
Right.
And of course, what's so sad about today, though, is you don't know if you're going to knock on the door and somebody's going to come to the door with a gun.
Right, yes.
I mean, I know that today is different than it was when I was growing up. You know, and Brother Ken and I were talking just a little bit ago about revivals. You know, you're lucky nowadays to have revivals anywhere from 3 to 4 or 5 days. But I can remember revivals would start on a Sunday, and they'd go a week, and when the week was up, it's like, oh, we're going to go another week.
Right.
You know, I remember the good old days. That's what it means to be Christ-like and make disciples.
Amen.
And we need to have revival today. In our, you know, and you know where revival starts? In our hearts and on our knees. If we want to have revival in our churches, and if we want to have revival within ourselves, we need to get down on our hands and knees and pray. And when we start praying, God is going to give you people that He wants you to witness there. He's going to give you people that He wants you to share the good news with. You probably already have people, after I said that, in your mind. But I guarantee you, once you go through praying about it and seeing what God wants for us, He's going to give you names. He's going to give you people.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And we need that today.
Yes, yes.
The only way, and like I said, 28, verse 19, if we want to grow our church, if we want to grow our country back the way that the country was going to be, we need to start making Christ.
there is none better than Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Here, he had 12 disciples, and from Sunday school lesson today, that at one point in time, before his death, burial, and resurrection, he was failed by his disciples miserably. He was failed by his disciples miserably. So as you go this week, the challenge is to go out and make Christ-like disciples. Be like St. Patrick. Be like St. Patrick. And like I said, when he passed away, in 486 AD, at 78 years old, and they had the parades that honored him because of all the ministry and the church schools that he founded, it was all because of that. But then the secular world got a hold of it and said, hey, look what we can do on St. Patrick's Day. We can turn into a sin-filled, how do you say that, Pastor Bob? Sin-filled, devil-making holiday. Yeah. We need to do this. We need to get St. Patrick's Day to be back to what it was.
Yes.
During the days of St. Patrick. He went out and spread the good news. He went out and spread the good news. Let's all be St. Patrick this week.
Amen.
Let's all be St. Patrick this week. And I'll be excited next week to hear, come up to me and tell me about your stories of people that you were able to witness to this week.
Amen.
I'm excited to hear the stories. And we can share that because that's what it's all about. That's why we come to the church. Somebody says, I had a person tell me, well, if you go by the Bible, we only have to go to church, the temple, three times a year. Let me tell you what. Where can you go and get what we have right now? Where can you go, if you're not in church, to get what we have right now? The Holy Spirit dwelling in this place. And we're in here with like-minded brothers and sisters.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
I'd much rather be sitting here with you guys than sitting at a football game. My wife said it the other day. She saw something on, I don't even know what it was, and this one football player had just signed a 3-year contract for $65.5 million and $48 million of that guaranteed. What's that going to do for him? What's that money going to do for him?
No,
absolutely anything. And the gentleman that signed that contract, just because I'm a sports person, I know he's not a Christian because I know I've seen the life that he lived. How all this stuff is displayed on TV. We want to see all the positive things on TV, but we don't see all the positive things on TV. We see all the negative things going on. If it comes to something that's about the church or about Jesus Christ, you don't see it like you do all this other stuff. You do not see it on TV. So we need to be the ones that are standing up and being Christ-like.
Amen.
We need to stand up and be Christ-like in all of that we do. That is one of the things that in the devotion that I was reading about St. Patrick. He said, when I went out spreading the word, he said, how to have the three-leafed shamrock. What was ironic is, he used that shamrock. When he was spreading the news and he was being Christ-like disciple, he used that shamrock as an example of the Trinity. It's three leaves, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. He used that, as part of his witnessing. So, and today we turn the shamrock or the three-leaf clover into, well, that's good luck. You know what good luck is? Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That three-leaf clover is not going to be good luck unless you believe in the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's where you're going to get your good luck.
Amen.
Right here. It's in our hearts. So as we close, let us pray, and everybody, all hearts and minds clear. Anybody have a word they want to share or testimony before we
Thank you. Thank you.
Preacher, I'm the great one.
Thank you.
Thank you.